Starting recording. Okay. There we go. Cool. All right. All right. Well, we just want to go ahead and start off today. We have a very special guest today. We have Shannon Bex. So Shannon, I don't want to like give your resume, but do you want to share with our Yes Love viewers kind of like who you are?
You know, I'm so like shy about that. But if I have, first of all, I apologize for my little country motif with less lighting. I got my cowboy hat and my reins up here. So I'm a little country girl at heart, as Albert knows. I've been performing forever, been in the group Danity Kane, multi-platinum recording artist, national and international touring, NBC show fame, laser dancer for the NBA, like pretty much dabbled in every area. And have my own little country EP out from a while ago. Done it all.
Yes. And, you know, so we promote a lot of love and kind of reaching out to different groups. And one of the biggest reasons we felt that we would like to talk to you is because we're focusing on minority empowerment, and women are very big minorities in this country. You know, there's a huge representation of women. And as we see, you know, we have the Me Too movement. We have a lot of women taking a lot more political offices. There's a change, you know, and I think that we need to make sure we acknowledge this. And so we definitely wanted to kind of just reach out to you and see what your take on women empowerment and you know, how women are the minority and what we can do to kind of move that movement forward. So just kind of to start off real quick, how would you define women empowerment?
How would I define it? Sorry, could I just mm-hmm.
Yes.
Ooh, I mean, women empowerment. Empowerment is defined just as it is, just the empowering of someone's not just career but self and status and ability to open doors and maneuver. I feel like women have been actually in that role for a long time, but more they haven't been as in the center of it like they are now. It has been as publicized, you know, a lot of powerful women have made some movements in history kind of on the down low, and now we actually have the opportunity to put it out there in front of everyone on the larger platform.
Yeah, and that's very important because, you're right. You know, I think that they haven't been given the voice or hasn't been the forefront of the movement. And I mean, I think we can agree that that's what we need to see more of that. You know, so you mentioned your country EP, you know, and it was titled "I'm a Woman," you know, so.
I didn't think about that.
in the title track, you know, I think that speaks a lot to the, you know, women and like the themes of being very powerful. And how does being a woman and that empowerment and now like maybe even like pressure, can I say, to be that strong woman in the eye of like, you know, people that are looking up to you? How do you feel like in your career that translates over?
That's a good question. And I can only really speak for me personally. Being a powerful woman and being in this industry, being in the spotlight period, there's a lot of, I think, pressure to show the younger generation that you can accomplish your dreams. You can still be a wife if you want to, a mother if you want to, an entrepreneur. We almost have to wear so many hats to prove ourselves versus just, sorry, but a lot of time men can just have that one accomplishment and, or, you know, that's it. They don't need to like have these multiple things under their belts to make people go, wow, you're amazing. I love Michael Jackson, but he was an incredible artist and singer. There's other things he did, but Beyonce, she needs to be running a marathon, having a baby, cooking the meal, having a cookbook out there while she's recording. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, we have to almost juggle all these plates to get any type of honorable recognition. And it's not said in a bitter way, and it's said to start some like, oh yeah, conversation. But those are my quickest examples. It just feels like you almost have to be a superwoman to be recognized at a higher level.
I totally agree with that, because the biggest thing is like, how that's like the biggest issue that men don't understand, that it's like exactly like you said, like they do one thing and it's like, wow, they're amazing, they're this, they're that. But to me, it's always been like, there's always somebody behind them and helping empower them, you know? And I love that Beyonce example, because she had to be a wife. She had to go through all this stuff publicly and be like the bigger person for people to really admire her and be like, oh my gosh, she's a strong woman, when it shouldn't have taken everything that she went through.
Absolutely. Just,
you know?
I partly say us women tend, and you know, in Danity Kane, we say this too, like we had to get aside ourselves, put aside our own wants and issues, and learn how to support one another and lift each other up as women. Because not to bash women, but we tend to be like, oh, I got that. I can do that. I do that. Beyonce, I do that every day. And, you know, come on, like, show me what you got. I think we also put each other with at a higher level of expectation, because as women, we tend to multitask a lot. We do already have spinning plates. I see my friends that have 3 kids and are cooking and are working and are keeping the house together. They're doing Beyonce in their house.
Yep.
And they're not getting that recognition. And so that's kind of the double-edged sword. Like, they deserve just as much recognition, praise, and thank yous as Beyonce does. So, you know, you can say, well, Beyonce has, you know, people to help her and she can fly first class in her own jet. Like, if I could do that, then I could make a cake too. So it's a little bit of that giving grace for one another and accepting on any level what it is we do accomplish.
Yeah, for sure. What do you think are some other issues that you think we as women face that men may not understand too well?
You know, I think something like the Me Too movement has really put a voice behind a lot of the issues women have faced. There's men that have faced that as well. We can't be ignorant to think that that doesn't happen on all levels, all genders. So I think that is a hard one. I've definitely, not a lot, but I've experienced the wonder that, oh wow, you, like, I'm an entrepreneur. I created a new app for children's streaming books, and with my brother and his partner, and I get kind of a look sometimes, like, so you're just like the face of it, right? Like, you're not really involved. I'm like, no, I'm involved. Like, kind of the recognition that women can be smart and accomplished, or what level of entertainment they're in, or what level of career they're in. We're capable.
Yeah, and it all goes back to what we were saying earlier about, like, wearing all those different hats. Like, we can do more than just be a mom or just be a professional singer or dancer, whatever you do. It's like, we're so much more than that. I love that.
Absolutely. Everybody has layers. Everybody is capable of so much. And, you know, sometimes I'll even admit I do that to my own self. And I realize I tend to be a people pleaser. And I realize I wear a lot of hats by my own choice, too. So it's a balance. Like, I can't get bitter at my husband because I do all these things when I actually took it on because I wanted to do it consciously because I knew I could. So I did it.
Yeah.
And then I'm mad at him for not helping. And he's like, okay, he's back right now.
My mom does that.
That quiet, like, mother, I'm going to get you one of these things. Yeah. Don't forget to fix your food.
That is so true. That is very true.
I hear this funny thing, like, be very nice to the person who has access to your toothbrush.
Oh, yes.
Yes. I heard a story from one of my friends that their sister was being really mean to them. And they did this really gross thing with her toothbrush and didn't tell her.
Matt, just saying, be careful.
I learned. I was like, okay.
I never would have even thought that. Sorry, sidebar. Anyways.
It's life. Now we know. Be nice to
never know. I love with you. That's funny.
What barriers do you see placed on women in the music industry?
You know, I think the barriers that have been placed have really been broken down a lot over the years. I can only imagine back in the day what the barriers really were. I mean, now we have women producing and engineering and songwriting and playing the instruments and being praised for it and giving credits for it. You know, I think nothing is really coming to mind. If anything, just just the equal respect of the studio and the space. You know, we've heard those stories of just because you're in there, you look good, doesn't mean you're wanting anything. You know, it's just focus and work. So if anything, just from my experience and what I've seen, that's the biggest barrier. Just being seen as equals across the board, no matter if you're in the boardroom or if you're in the studio.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, and you know, and what, touching back on something you said earlier, you know, like even in that dynamic of like a girl group, you know, the different personalities, do you feel that not just like as competition, but a lot of times like the media or society pins women against each other, and that is a huge issue. Do you still see a lot of that?
Absolutely. Comparison from maybe your body type or even ethnicity to your talent and ability. If you're not this, then you must be that. Of course, you see it all the time.
Yeah, even as women, we're not always equal. One is always better than the other. One is always skinnier. One is always thicker. It's always like, there's always someone who's better. And I think we all really need to get better on that, because if we're so about women empowerment, then we're taking away some of that when we are talking down on other people and comparing them so much.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Absolutely. So how would you say that empowerment of women plays a role in your musical career? Because I know you guys are a girl group, and so that's huge.
Absolutely. You know, I'm really proud of us and how, you know, we've been through a lot of life together, and we've come to respect each other's journey. Like I'd mentioned before, the way someone reacts to you or the way you react to someone has so much to do with past things, whether it's their own family history or just the own things they've gone through that have given them this like red flag feeling. It's never just about that one moment and about that one thing or that one subject at that one time. It's always an iceberg underneath. And so having the patience to understand that, patience is huge. You said grace is huge.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. That's true. Do you feel, you know, so like a big thing for me is, and like I grew up on Christina Aguilera, and my favorite phase was the Dirty era. Like I loved her empowerment, her sexuality came into place. You know, how do you feel? Because I know like you are very classy, like everything you do and how you carry yourself, mm-hmm. just so classy, but you can still be sexy. So how do you kind of skirt the line of like, what do you do?
That is a very good question. It's challenging and to each their own. But for me, it's just, yeah, it's about your choices and realizing, you know, lots of times when we're younger, we want to wild out and just prove a point. But that point's going to be seen for 10, 20 plus years to come. So I try to always have a 10 to 20 year mentality deep inside, like, okay, what would I be wanting to be in 20 years from now? Is that going to affect this? Like, I don't overthink it. It's just a bit of a natural decision for me. But, and I'm, you know, trained ballerina. So everything I do has, you know, a little bit of posture and poise. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Awesome. Do you feel like, you know, because like I always wonder, like, you know, obviously, when you do shows, like you'll wear, like if you wear, like, do you feel the pressure to be, like, wear more revealing outfits, or like you're like, I'm just gonna wear a turtleneck today? Like, how does that play into it?
I love being able to rock a turtleneck and some great stilettos. And I don't mind, you know, showing a little midriff, showing that it's just about choices, really. Mm-hmm. Honestly, this go around on tour, I think I've worn the least amount I've ever worn.
Really?
And I'm like, what the heck? I'm almost 40, and I'm like in a bathing suit. What's going on? And I just laugh because Aubrey, she usually dresses me. I'm always like, what do you want me to wear? Okay, cool. Sounds good. I'm good. And I was like, you got me wearing nothing out on these streets. But to be fair, she still makes sure like my booty's covered enough for my comfort. You know, I've got shorts on, I don't have the thong on, you know, like my comfort zone of choice. So I'm like, all right, fine, I'll let it go for now.
And figuring out what you feel confident and sexy in.
Absolutely. And trust me, we've had our conversations in the past, like, why don't you just wear this or that? I'm like, this is just what I want. And then finally she's like, okay, That's fine. I'll let you. I'm like, you can wear what you want. I'm gonna wear what I want.
She's great. Well, and it's funny because like this is one of my favorite conversations to always have. It's just like the Halloween costumes, you know, like the pressure for women to be sexy, you know, like, because it's about comfort. Because I think that if there's a choice of sexy, like, if you feel empowered and that's you, do it. But like, I think there's sexy in so many different categories of sexy and what can be sexy.
Absolutely. I do agree it's become too categorized as sexy is less. Sexy is more skin. Mm-hmm. I don't think that needs to be. It doesn't have to be a gorgeous woman, but there just be a woman that has a confidence and is walking down the street in a turtleneck, jeans, and maybe stilettos, because, you know, you got and elude just this, just confidence and sexiness that she doesn't need to be strutting down the street in a bikini. I completely agree with that. And that shouldn't define sexy, really. Yeah. The less you wear shouldn't be like, okay, well, that must be sexy. I've got nieces, and that's something, it's a very fine line. You know, I started out in the NBA, and I had many conversations with my coach over what I was wearing. I'm like, I don't know, you know, I'm not wearing that, I'm not comfortable with this. And she's like, okay, you're an NBA dancer, but I understand. Let's talk, let's figure it out. So I found my own boundaries and my yes and my own no's, which is important for everybody. But it is hard. Oh, it is hard right now. Instagram and Facebook and like everything you do is out there. And my heart goes out to my 13-year-old and my 9-year-old nieces. I'm like, what are they absorbing and what are they seeing? So it's a good conversation to have. No, sexy is not about skin.
Yeah. Going back to like the social media stuff, it just opens the door for so much social comparison. Just going back to that. Sometimes as women, we don't empower each other because we're like, I want to look like her, or like, you know, just things here and there. And
it's hard enough growing up. I remember the days just being in a line at the grocery store, and that was all you saw was the magazine covers. Yeah. And now it's like 100 of those on your feed. And I'm a grown woman, and I still am like, maybe I should color my hair. Maybe, you know, it's just ingrained in us to have fun and glamour and improve, but it can be a very confusing mixed message for a generation that doesn't even, they're just discovering themselves.
Yeah, and they're so young nowadays, like on Instagram and the whole nine, and it is like, what are they taking in, you know?
And what are they doing and what are their behaviors? That's something, when I was growing up, I always remember my mom, like, I'd have friends that were the same age, but they were able to do everything at once. They were able to get their ears pierced and wear makeup and get that little heel all at once. And mom was like, what do they have to look forward to? Like, progression in the process of growing up and remembering those days of being a child and not having to grow up too fast. There's something about that pacing and growth, I think, is really important. And I don't think we're necessarily missing out. I think people are aware of it, but we just gotta still be aware of it.
Yeah. That's very true. I mean, we have to remember that because the youth is very impressionable, and they see what they see and they like it and they wanna be that.
And they're our next leaders. And it's intriguing to me, all this conversation. I could go on and on and on, but it's so intriguing because it's going to create the way they communicate, the way they relate to one another. We have no idea what they as adults are going to be like now. So it's really important that we all take a stand now and start making a good impression for them.
Yeah, that's true. And like, you know, that's one of the projects we're taking on in like hopefully mid-2019 is a fashion show, but we're calling it UBU, and kind of getting all body size, all skin colors, genders, and people, like, the concept's going to be, we live in a world that's black and white. There are some things that are set in stone, and then there's other things where you kind of just, you design your life how you want to be. So as long as they wear black and white, something black, something white, and then like pretty much celebrate themselves and how they dress, and just walk the catwalk and just show, like, I am that beautiful person. It doesn't matter. I don't have to be the, you know, standard type of beauty. You know, I'm my own beauty. So,
yeah. And who gave that standard type of beauty?
Yeah.
Where did that come from?
Yeah.
So, I have no idea where this came from.
Yeah.
It is way too much, though.
It's a lot of pressure.
You know?
It is. And, you know, it's funny because the standard beauty now wasn't the standard beauty 20 years ago. Wasn't the standard beauty 20 years before that. You know, every 100 of years, the standard of beauty changes. So that's something that also this younger generation is not, they don't understand. Because everything is now, everything is their world, and everything is this.
We were actually joking earlier because I was reading on, I think it was on Instagram, that low-rise jeans are coming back. So everyone was like, no, no. Like the super low ones. Yes. And everyone was like, we just worked on getting big butts now. Like, how are we going to like now just try to sit down? Like, did people sit when they were?
Believe I've said that. I was like, we just wait to all these girls who got the booties. I'm like, the fashion's gonna change. It always changes. It's funny.
Yeah, I mean, boot cut was a thing way back now, like, and now it's all about the skinny jeans. So I'm kind of like excited to see it all come back. Yeah. You know, see how that works out. I am
cringing at some of the fashion that I'm laughing because they sound like my mother. I was like, I wore that in high school. Oh, if I only kept that, like the Tommy Hilfiger, Adidas, Calvin Klein stuff that's happening. Oh, yeah. That was all my high school.
Oh, my gosh. Baby fat was in when I was growing up. And now I'm like, nobody wears baby fat anymore. Like, what is going on?
Sure, it'll come back around.
I'm sure, too.
Well, we need to prepare ourselves for butt cracks and thongs. They're on their way.
And those big, like, chunky. Remember the flip-flops or the Andre with the chunk plus?
Yeah, like five inches. Or like the jelly ones started coming back. I've seen people in them this summer. I was like, oh my gosh, I wore those when I was five.
Okay, but I'm not alone. Okay, I was like,
okay. That's so funny.
Awesome. I'm not alone. So an important a question I'm really curious about is like, how in your marriage do you assign like gender roles? Like, how does that work in your house?
Oh, no, that's great. And it's not like we sit down and be like, okay, my husband is Filipino. So he comes from a very traditional Filipino family. They're from the Philippines directly. He's the first generation. So we're actually, it sounds silly, but we go through counseling and we go to counseling because we're not equipped to fully dig deep and understand the way each other ticks. Even if we want to, we could sit down and have the most identical conversation in a counselor's office that we do at home. But until you have somebody that can help kind of break down the whys, it's been very amazing and beneficial. And I encourage people to do that because we're still working through stuff like that. We've had the conversation of kids and the conversation of me being gone on the road so much. And I'm like, well, I wasn't going to be a stay-at-home wife. I'm a mom. And then it's like, I never wanted you to be my mom. So then he's confused why I'm upset. And, you know, he never drew the lines, but it's something that constantly has been discussed and understood. And again, with grace, and when you move in grace, it's much easier to like accomplish things versus like pointing fingers and getting upset. So I can't get mad at him how he was raised and kind of understanding of a family household and what that looked like to him. And I can't assume he understood my wants and needs the second we got married. So a lot of assumption happens in relationships. And sometimes until you have an argument or you face a crossroads, you don't even know it's a situation to be discussed. So it's constantly evolving. But, you know, he cooks, and so I'm happy, and I'll clean, whatever, still clean. But, you know, it's more or less not like, okay, these are the roles, and this is the gender that should be accomplishing it. It's more like a team effort, and who can step in. Sometimes it's both of your roles to step in. Whether it's picking up each other's weight and helping carrying each other. It's teamwork.
Yeah.
That's very key, I think, you know, because I think, you know, for so long people are like, well, women cook, men don't. And it's like, not every woman on earth knows how to cook or wants to cook, you know?
Oh, yeah. Like, husband would be like, don't cook.
Same.
Yeah, Jaylee can't cook.
I don't belong in the
kitchen. And I love to cook, so, you know, I mean.
See, and that's the beauty of it. And you're right. And society, not our current society really put that label, but the earlier generations did. And, you know, we could get upset at them for that, but they were just they were just trying and surviving and evolving from what life was. And it was really rough out in the Midwest and in the, you know, in the wagon trails. And it wasn't like women couldn't accomplish what the men were doing or vice versa. But I'm sorry, the men that were out hunting and driving cattle with these coarse hands really weren't the best one with the baby at night because they weren't giving the most, you know what I'm saying? So the way we had to survive kind of put us into gender roles that just all of a sudden had to be defined. And we're working past that. We're living and evolving differently now. So having grace with what the past was and evolving forward.
I totally love your perspective because I think for me, it's really difficult to even think about that, to be like, okay, well, the man was out working so much. I mean, that I never really put that into perspective. I always just took it as, wow, I was raised with these like roles, like in my family and stuff, but I never thought about that. So that's definitely a really good point.
It wasn't safe for women. My husband and I talk about this all the time because I live on property out in Oregon. So we're like close to that, you know, country like reality. You know, we had water delivered to our house. So it's like, and realizing back in the day, it wasn't safe for women. You wouldn't want your woman. He's like, I would not want you to go downtown and be working with or out on the range with 20 men who hadn't seen a woman in 5 months. Like, there also was a safety factor to it. Not like, oh, you're not capable, but just reality, you know, safety factor as well. So because of those, you know, times, we kind of naturally started getting a rhythm. And now we're just kind of finding a different rhythm.
Okay. A big thing as women is, how can men really become a part of this woman empowerment movement? Like, I feel like there's that fine line, you know, between what a man can and can't do. What do you think about that?
I mean, I think women and men are capable of everything and anything. I don't think it's only one person or one gender that can accomplish it. I don't. I think, like we discussed before, respecting each other. It's not about, okay, we as women are going to be empowered, so we're going to bash men down and prove ourselves. No, that's not necessary. And I think everyone's capable of the roles and multiple roles. So I just, again, grace and just acceptance and love and teamwork, whether you're married or not, or your friends or coworkers, whatever it is, it's teamwork and everyone pulling their own weight. Because really a lot of it comes down to just humanity and how we just treat each other as people. Like, that's number one.
Yeah, I love that. So many times women, while trying to empower themselves, they bash men down. And that's not, I don't think that's right at all.
It's not a healthy
I totally agree with you.
What message would you share with any woman or any person that feels oppressed?
Try to find out why. Figure out why. It's rarely just a one thing or one person. Sometimes it's like I said, I'm reading a book, Emotionally Healthy Woman. Oh my goodness. It could be so many factors, but if it's obvious, if it's an unhealthy situation, you know what it is, be brave and move and you have control and power of your life. And it might feel like there's no options out there, but there's always options. There's always someone that wants to step in and help. There's always somebody there for you. So try and find out why if you don't know why. If you're in an unsafe area, life, career, home, whatever it is, get safe first before you try and dig. Like I said, it's an iceberg. We all have icebergs that more than just the surface of what we see. But help, ask for help. Try to get around those people and friends that aren't emotionally driven. And a lot of times that's a good counselor or career coach or life coach, someone who's more factually driven and can give you tools to maneuver. You know, it's nice to like vent or gossip to friends or family, but sometimes that just puts you in a perpetual like cycle of negativity and emotions, and you never really resolve the issues.
So name one woman who has inspired your career and then another one, if it's a different one, who has inspired you in your personal life.
Oh, my career, huh? Oh my gosh, I'm inspired by every successful woman. Are you kidding me? I there's not one that I remember looking to as the epitome of like, every successful one is inspiring to me. As far as in my own personal life, the women in my family, they don't necessarily move and maneuver the way I have or can, but the foundation that they laid and the type of women they are, their core, their values, their love, just the way they give, that's huge. That they're just so selfless, and they've laid such a beautiful foundation for me. It doesn't mean to be, you know, walked on. It doesn't mean to be taken advantage of, but just the selfless women in my life.
Beautiful.
And I hate to do this. I'm at 1% and my charger's in the other room and I don't want us to cut off. I'm scared.
Yes, we will. Well, actually, that was the last question.
Yeah,
so just kind of wrapping it up, you know, where can people follow you and kind of what's up and next for Shannon Bex and like what you're doing in your personal life and career?
Well, Instagram is Shannon Bex, so Shannon_Bex, Facebook, Shannon Bex. I just released a streaming service for kids books called Books. That's exciting. And of course, I've got my tour date with myself and Danity Kane. So a lot of fun things around the corner.
Yes.
Awesome. Well,
we hope to find you on tour. It's really been a pleasure.